record this. There you go. All right, welcome everybody. This is Jesse Neuman. I'm the director of Musicworks. This is Musicworks session 316, and we are talking about music and emotions. We are joined by the illustrious Tharun, a teenager in our area who I'm told has a relationship with music, is interested in music. That's a thing in his life. We'll find out if he's full of it and lying or not. Tharun, how are you doing this morning?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm okay. You're handling the quarantine situation without bouncing off the walls too much?
Yeah, trying not to lose my mind, but yeah, hanging in there.
I feel like that's the best we can do at this point. And Tharun, just for everyone at home, tell us what grade you're in and how old you are.
I'm in 11th grade. I'm just turned 17.
Ah, congratulations. Now, what is your driver's license situation? What's happening there?
So I have my permit, and I was supposed to get my license on my birthday, March 25th, but because of quarantine, I haven't gotten it yet.
All right. So I guess that's bad for you, but good for me, because I think if I were to see you on the road, I would like have to literally veer off and hide in a ditch until you pass.
Probably.
As responsible as a person you are. Your brother is, how is he handling, this shift? And Tharun has a twin brother who's the same age. So you seem at peace with the non-licensed situation. How's he handling it?
Yeah, pretty good. I keep taunting him saying like, he's never going to touch the car if we get one, cause we're probably going to share a car. So the car's all mine. But
are you the older of the two?
Yeah. 2 minutes older.
2 minutes means shotgun.
It's a lot. Basically. It's a lot. Yeah.
It's a real thing. Yeah. Cool. Well, the reason I have you here today is, we're going to talk a little bit about, music and emotion. And, that's a little bit of an abstract idea, but, the basic thrust of the discussion, and for everyone at home too, is, can we use music as a tool in our lives to help us process emotion? So especially now we're in a crazy time. You know, we don't have some of the outlets that we normally have. We can't go and see our friends. We can't go to the gym. We can't go to a party and, you know, like just decompress. We can't even go, like for me, I often go to the coffee shop and like kind of take my work and my books out and just be there with the crowd. We can't do all those things. So more than ever, we can use music as a tool to help handle our emotions. So let me just start off and asking you, Tharun, what would you say, and you know, there's no right or wrong answer to this, but what would you say the role of music is in your life at this moment as a 17-year-old going through high school and now dealing with the quarantine, but you know, like even up leading up to that, where does music fit in terms of like sleep, eat, exercise, tweet, I don't know, whatever you guys do with your social media. And then somewhere in there is music. Tell me what that means to you.
Well, I think like, obviously it's a mode of expression because like each song means a different thing to me. Like each genre means a different thing, but also it's like a method of exploration. It's like exploring my interests. If I'm running, I listen to a certain song. If I'm sleeping, I'm listening to a certain song. So it's kind of like if I'm doing different things, I'm listening to different things. So yeah, I guess it's a method of exploration. Also, it's fun to see like what other people are listening to. What am I listening to? How does that compare? Mm-hmm. Like what, like the hip songs, what's out right now? What are some old songs? Like, so things like that. It's kind of like where I fit in life and music, but it's also exploration, discovering new things. And so yeah, it's kind of like a mix of all those different things.
So it sounds like you have at least two prongs to this approach. The first is in your day-to-day life, it's almost like a soundtrack for what's going on with you. You mentioned running, you mentioned sleeping, everything in between, right? How music, different types of music will accompany whatever it is that you're doing in the moment. And then you also said, this is interesting in terms of connecting to other people, like seeing sort of where you are, like in a different dimension of like where I am compared to everyone else around me, even compared to like the timeline of history, like what songs are just brand new coming out and like what direction they're going in. Also like what came before me and how can I go back and dig back with that. Can you tell me a little bit more about how do you do that, that second part? Like, how do you see what's going on with everybody? How do you investigate the past or look forward? Like, what's your main method of doing that? Obviously we're online a lot right now, but even going back, how do you compare notes, so to speak, with your peers around you?
Well, I think social media is a really big part of that, because I go on social media as does everybody, and you see like people posting like music that they're listening to, or like in their videos they'll have like music playing in the background. You're like, I know who the artist is, but I've never heard the song. So like then I go on Spotify, look it up, like, okay, I like this, start listening to it, add it to the playlist. Mm-hmm. And then the same thing for like older songs too. Like sometimes I'm in music class with like, I do a program at Newark, you know, about NJPAC. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of times we listen to old songs and we listen to like technicalities in like music and what the musicians are doing and what kind of drums are using and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And then I kind of like catch on like the songs we're listening to and look up the artists and listen to those songs. So it's kind of like what I'm learning, what I'm seeing, and then reflecting that into like what I'm listening, basically.
Sounds kind of like a webbing out, not the World Wide Web, like an actual web shape.
Yeah.
Like kind of going out in terms of like, oh, I learned this in class. Oh, this person said that. Oh, this person posted that. Oh, this person I had that in their video, and then you can kind of expand out. And you said something very interesting. You said, oh, I know that artist, but I don't know that song, or I know that song, but I don't know that artist. So that's a way also to kind of branch off. It's funny because when I was a kid or teenager, like a gazillion years ago, it was much more, I feel like my exploration was much more like a line, you know, it was like forwards and backwards, because we didn't have the internet and we didn't have people posting, you know. So it's like for me to find out what someone was listening to, it would have to be a direct conversation, like at a direct point in time, at a rehearsal or at a class, whatever. And then I go back and much later, or like later on, would have to then go investigate that. So it was a much slower plotting process. But it seems like you're really taking advantage of the upside of social media. I mean, everybody's like, it's so easy to be like, oh, it's trash, we're always online, we're staring at screens. And a lot of that can be true if you abuse it, but it sounds like there's a big upside to that social media investigating as well.
Yeah.
Do you ever go like YouTube digging, like just go onto YouTube and kind of like fall down the rabbit hole? Yeah,
definitely. Like you play one song and then it comes up on the side of the YouTube thing. Like, okay, I want to listen to this, and just keep going.
Right. Cool. Awesome. All right. I want to talk a little bit about, go back to the first part about how we use music and emotions in our daily life. So I'm going to just go over here. This is a little bit of a program that I've been developing. And I just want to share some like general points, right? So music is an excellent and vital tool for helping us process emotion. All right, so what do I mean by process emotion? I mean that emotions come up and they're there, and we have to work through them in some way. So like before quarantine, especially, you know, like, or some of the ways, or I should ask you, like, what are some of the ways that you process emotion?
I don't know. It's like my actions, I think. Like, what do I do when I'm feeling emotion? Mm-hmm. Like, for example, if I'm mad, I go running. If I'm tired, I sleep. So it's kind of like the actions that you do that control the emotions or influence emotions.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, like you said, music is an excellent tool. So I think processing emotion, like if I'm sad or I listen to a happy song. Mm-hmm. So things like that, I guess.
Yeah. So there's definitely, well said, I agree with all that. There's an action component to it. And there's sort of a mental component to it. I like the way you use the word control. I think that's a good place to start, because, you know, sometimes we think about emotions as happening to us, right? And I'm not a licensed therapist, so I shouldn't get like too crazy about this, but, you know, like that's something we can all understand, is emotions happen to us. Like, oh, this like terrible thing happened to me and now I'm mad. Or like, oh, like, you know, like a so-and-so is dealing with whatever and that makes me jealous, and so now that happened to me. And that word control implies implies action, implies some ownership. It's like, I can control my reaction to this situation, right? So, and you can do that by running, by sleeping, by listening to music, which we'll get to, by talking to people, by meditating, by writing, whatever it is. I'm gonna go to the second point, which is that we cannot avoid complex emotions and we shouldn't avoid complex emotions. You know, complex we'll get into a little bit more, but when you're younger, you think like, oh, this is bad and it makes me feel bad. And now I'm happy again, right? When you get older, it's not always as clear. I'm sure you've been in situations where you've had kind of mixed emotions and not exactly sure how to deal with that. Everyone feels emotions differently and everyone hears music differently. And that's a big theme that we come across in many of the classes that we deal with. And I want to make this point very loudly, is that good musicians make music that resonates with these emotions. Good musicians are not just about musicianship. That stuff helps. It helps to be a good technician. And obviously, like, you're a music student, everybody should learn the technique. But that technique is only worthwhile if it's like you're using it to get to someplace and to share something artistic and beautiful and enjoyable. It doesn't mean that it has to be pretty, but it should be something that people can resonate with. So like when you said before, when you're feeling sad, you listen to a happy song. I agree. And I also might counter and say that when you're sad, sometimes people will listen to a sad song.
Yeah.
Because they want to sort of like sit in that moment, like be with someone who understands that, you know? It's like the classic joke, like when you break up with someone, like you go and you listen to your breakup song. It's like, well, why? Like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, if you're already feeling terrible, why would you want to feel more terrible? But we all do that because, you know, like it helps us kind of get, you know, get through that. And I'm not wishing heartbreak on you or anybody else, but just saying, like, mathematically speaking, it's probably going to happen. And then that last point is that we can experience them vicariously, meaning that, and this is especially important now, I think, is that if we are like completely neurotically obsessed and compulsive and angry, rather than go out and look for a fight and like beat the stuffing out of somebody or like break something valuable, like I really do believe that you can sit with music and experience that vicariously. And so, you know, with that, it's a much healthier way to process that. Have you, without getting too specific, can you share with us, maybe a time or a situation or even like a time period in your life or a week or a month or something that where you're going through a situation where music helped you, go through an emotion without taking a physical action? So like, rather than go and deal with, rather than go and do X, Y, or Z, you were able to process some of that using only music. And if that's too abstract a question, you can say pass.
Yeah, that's a good question. So I did a summer camp last summer, and it was like a 3-4 week thing. And I was away from my parents for most of that time. So I kind of felt homesick. And so I started listening to music. I started listening to some old tunes that brought back some memories of younger times, childhood times.
So old songs, meaning songs that were made a long time ago or songs that you had been listening to in an older time or earlier time?
Both.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they were both older songs and I listened to them older when I was younger. You too.
Cool. Okay. So what was that? What was that? Did that help? What was the reaction to that?
Yeah, well, I think it brought back like memories, like it brought a warm feeling. It kind of filled me up so that I wasn't missing my family as much. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of comforting, like listening to songs that I listened to before. And so, yes, often I find that like I do that sometimes, like if I'm having a bad day at school, I'll come home and I turn on like one of those like old tunes from a while ago and it kind of, yeah.
Yeah. It's amazing how music can kind of like tie you to a certain place in your life, a certain time in life. I think many of us, if we don't have, will have at some point a song that's just like oh, I'm back here, like I'm right back there, you know? So
yeah.
Cool. That's a great example. All right, I'm gonna share my screen with you because I wanna move to this little map that I have. And let's see if I can engineer. Oh, it's amazing. I'm a technological wizard. Let me just play some music and then we'll go from there. Let's see. You want to take a guess who this is? Not to put you on the spot.
I don't know.
This is a how would you can you name this style?
It's funky for sure.
Okay,
it's so, kind of a I don't know.
Yeah, so this is I'll take funky. This is Bob Marley, and okay. So my first question is and I know this is a little bit of a loaded question because I'm sharing you can see my graphic over here, but
yeah.
If you had to, like, on a very basic level, does this song strike you as more positive, more happy, or more negative, more sad?
Definitely happy, more positive.
So, again, like, for everybody at home thinking, like, oh man, like, he's gonna just give Tharun, like, super easy questions. Like, we're just sort of starting out, but I wanna establish a little bit of context, right? Which is that if you think about one axis of your feelings as positive to negative, right? Of course, we have more complicated emotions, which we're gonna get into. Like, I'm thinking sometimes that feeling of jealousy can be a complicated emotion, because if you're like have someone that you know and you're happy for them, but you're also like upset that you yourself didn't get it, that can be like a real, like a sticky kind of point. But, you know, like generally speaking, if you're listening to something like this, most people would have that same reaction, is that this is kind of like a more positive kind of sounding thing, right? Mm-hmm. If I was gonna go to the opposite side, if I played something like this, I'd be willing to bet that most people would have a slightly different reaction. So this is a song by Meshell and Ndegeocello, but she actually copied, not copied, this is a cover she did of a Prince song.
Those kinds of cars don't pass you every day. I used to cry for Tracy, so I want to see him again. Sometimes life isn't always that way. Sometimes it snows in April. Sometimes I feel so sad. Sometimes I wish that life was never ending. All good things they say never last. Springtime was always my favorite time.
So I'm gonna pause that there. So what, or I should ask, first of all, would you agree that seems more like a sad, sad piece of music than the happier one we listened to before.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. And yeah, I mean, I guess you have to say that because like staring at you want to make that, but I think most people would agree. Now that's not to say that it's a bad thing. And this is a really important point that I want to make. It's not to say that if something is sad, it's bad. Just the same way that's not to say that if you are dealing with sad emotions, that that's a bad emotion that you need to get out, right? I think we've all like been through enough, you know, like to, well, I shouldn't say that, but I would hope that a lot of us have been through enough in our lives and talked to enough people to realize that sadness is a useful thing, right? Like when you're sad, it means you're upset or you miss something and that thing was important to you and it's important to process that emotion, right? So, you know, like going back to our, we were talking about before, if you are feeling happy and you're in a good place, you're in a good mood and you want to listen to something that resonates with that feeling, right? Then Bob Marley is a great choice. Like it's not like almost universally like happy and people get into that. Yeah. If you are in a sad place, in a difficult place, you can listen to something happy like Bob Marley to kind of get your spirit back up. Or if you can put on something like that song we just listened to, this Meshell Ndegeocello, it's a beautiful song. The chords are lush and flowing. The sound is rich. Her voice is gorgeous. The sentiment is really difficult. And I didn't play a lot of it, but this is a song about losing somebody to an illness and they've gone to a better place. And that line, all good things they say never last. It's like kind of a crusher line, right? It's like, I had this great thing and it didn't last. So, but what that does is it helps you like be in that sad place. Like it helps you kind of stew in that place. And, you know, that's a really important thing to be able to go through. Could you see yourself using a song like that in that scenario, or do you feel like you typically go to a happier song or a mix, or is there ever a time, I just thought of this now, but where you're feeling like kind of happy and pepped up and you'd actually want to bring yourself back down to a more even place that you go for a sad, or I don't know, what are your reactions to all of this?
Well, typically, like even if I'm happy or sad, I usually tend to listen to more happier, like groovy, like upbeat songs. Mm-hmm. But I feel like I think I would listen to some like sad songs that are like slower, maybe calm me down a little bit. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think the situation varies, but usually I'm more attracted to the upbeat songs. But yeah.
I would agree with that. I wonder, I'm just thinking as you said that, it's like, I wonder if it's the kind of thing, this is going to be like super deep, so prepare yourself to have your mind blown, but like we're attracted to the happier stuff, but like we fall back on the sadder stuff when we need it the most kind of thing. Like is not, I mean, also not such a bad just like way of looking at life in general. It's like, yeah, like none of us wake up and are like, I think today will be like a day when I process all my sad stuff. Yeah. You know, like that's typically not how it works, at least for me, probably for most people. But yeah, like we are attracted to that sort of positive half, side of the spectrum. But that sad part is there for us when we need it. So cool. I also liked what you said about if I need something to calm me down, right? Because that actually brings us to the next point that I want to make. So we have this axis, right? And it's a little artificial. All of this is like just a way of looking at music. So for everybody who's listening, like, please don't feel like you have to either like buy into this right away or not. Like this is just like a crude example or a way of looking at it. But if we do think about things from a spectrum of from happy to sad, we could also look on the opposite axis, which is moving from active to passive, right? And so I was thinking about the behaviors we do during the day, active and passive. So like you mentioned before, running, right? Mm-hmm. And that's obviously an active thing. And that's not to say that you might be having like a calm sort of moment inside while you're doing it, but there's active behavior and there's active emotions. There's also passive behavior and passive emotions. So like you said, needing something to calm you down, right? My thinking is that on the passive side, right? You can have passive emotions that are more positive. So I put dreamy, relaxed, pensive. You could have passive emotions that are more negative, more sad. So feeling melancholy or afraid or depressed. Those are all more or less like passive feelings. They're feelings where you don't want to take action, where you're sort of sitting literally and metaphorically sitting with a feeling. And it could be positive or negative, but you're not looking to move on that. I'm going to cue up a song, and this is not a contest, but I'm going to play something and I'd like to hear, we'll listen to a minute or so, your reaction to the music and where you think it would fit on the spectrum from happy to sad on this passive side. Okay. Mm-hmm. So let's go with this.
Though the words are true, the state is all news. Wrapped in your arms, I can't feel the burn. Wrapped in your arms, I can't feel the burn. My words will dry upon the skin, just like a name I remember hearing. Wild winter, warm coffee, mom's gone. Do you love me? Blazing summer, cold coffee, baby's gone. Do you love me? Grab me in your arms, I can feel it burn. Rock me in your arms, I can feel it burn. Get up, get down, get up, get down. Feel the generation and start. See the next one break. Get up, get down. Get up, get down, get up. Sit in the seat with your feet changed. Get up, get down, get up, get down. Be the generation and stop. See the next one waiting. Get up, get down, get up, get down, get up. Sit in the seat with your feet changed.
I'm going to pause that there. So talk to me about that song. What are your reactions? What'd you notice? Like, dislike? And then let's see if maybe we can place that on our kind of emotional map and figure out where that might work for us.
Mm. So I think like, first off, like just when I was first hearing the song and like the beat without any lyrics, and the groove kind of felt relaxed, but also dreamy, so like closer to the happy part of the axis. But then, like as the lyrics came in, and I was like concentrating on what the musician was saying, kind of felt more towards like the sad, passive area, like melancholy. Mm-hmm. So I don't really, it's like in the middle. I guess like the beat is driving the music forward, but then the lyrics are holding it back. And I couldn't really like get like a deeper meaning of the lyrics, but like when she was saying like get up, get down, and the baby's gone, the mom's gone. And then in the middle, she was talking about coffee and winter and summer and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So like all those feelings and seasons and all that kind of drew me more towards like the lower sad passive end.
That answer is way better than anything I could have prepared. That's fantastic. First of all, I just want to point out, I should have said this before, but we spent about almost 3 minutes on that song. And I know that for some of you watching, that might have just felt like an eternity to stare at my stupid face and like Tharun's like less stupid face, you know, like just kind of listening. But I just wanted to make the point that listening to music and doing nothing else is really, really good for you. I know how challenging it is to always be zooming between screens and doing something and feeling productive. I totally get that. And we often listen to music while we're doing other things, but I would really encourage you, especially now, to take some time, even if it's like just 5 minutes at the beginning of your day or 5 minutes at the end of your day, start with that, to just listen and let it happen. You don't have to be thinking about, you know, preparing a book report about the song or anything like that, but just to listen. So I commend you for that, Tharun, and thank you to everyone who's taken on that challenge. I think what you said is fantastic, and I totally agree. This was this is a song called Coffee by a band named Sylvan, Esso. It's a singer and a drummer who's really more of a DJ, and so they sample things, and he kind of jockeys them live, and she sings. So they have a really interesting mix of electronic sounds and acoustic sounds and pre-recorded things and things happening live. This was from my Dreamy playlist. So it did come from there. But what you said was so interesting about how listening to the lyrics, that it sort of pulled it in and out of in and out of that positive negative axis. And I think that's a perfect example of how, yes, like we can use something like this as a tool to illustrate what music means to us and where it feels, but also that it's all flexible. I wonder if you listen to this song after a really great run, if your reaction or the way you took this song in and what it helped process would be different if you listened to this song after like maybe a 3-hour class where you're just like banging your head against the wall, not quite getting the material. And then the teacher's like, great, go home. Like there's a test next week, and you get home and you drop your books and you put it on. What do you, talk to me about that. Look into the imaginary future and see two Tharuns, one that enjoys a run and comes to this song, and one that deals with some crazy teacher BS and then comes to this song. How do you hear the song differently, or is it not? Is it the song is itself and that's all you need?
That's interesting. Yeah, I think I agree with that. I think when
I'm a pretty interesting guy. I have a lot of interesting things to say.
I think if I was coming back from a run, like my heartbeat is racing, and then I turn on this song, I think it would feel more positive, more dreamy. And then I think I would focus more on the beat, the groove, then rather than listen deep for the lyrics. But then if I was like after like a long day at school or whatever, 3-hour class, and I come home, like lay on my bed staring at the ceiling, I think I would focus less on the groove and the beat and more on the lyrics and
interesting
listen to the song deeper. So
interesting. Yeah. Wow, super cool. Yeah, it's funny, I'm not used to, I usually go more to the music because I'm an instrumentalist, so I go more to the music than the words. But that's interesting to hear. I hadn't thought about that depending on where you are, like you're accessing different parts of the music, and you know, like, or you could say you're using different parts and not using them in a bad way. Like music is there for you to be appreciated and to be experienced by you. So if you're more pulled to the story and the lyrics, that's an excellent way to like use the music. If you're responding in more of a physical way, like rhythm is definitely a physical thing and tonality is a physical thing. You know, like if you heard that Bob Marley song and you didn't speak English, you would still know that that's a happy song. Because there's something about the rhythm and the tonality that makes you feel a certain way. If you're listening to a song that's, you know, like there are certain songs that have like a kind of fun sound to them, but then the lyrics like have a much darker thing going on underneath it.
Yeah. Cool.
All right. Excellent answer. I'm going to play you something else. Let's do the same thing. All right. So talk to me about where this lands on the, let's see, where this lands on the sort of positive to negative axis, and where it might land for you on the active to passive axis. Okay. Let's go with this one.
What's in between? I'll never know. I'm thinking now. I'll probably never know. The stitch I did, that boat you rowed, drifts off so suddenly, and I can't follow. What's between is standing fair has always been and is still strongly there, but you're not me. And I'm not scared. What does it mean? What's in between? A dream, you showed up there. I was with our friend. You were on your bicycle coming home late at night. Yes, I know. You don't even have a bicycle, but you took us in, and time went by. We sat on couches, and I was very shy, and to my hopes, I must be chained, cause you knelt by me, touched my neck and whispered things. What a price has to be paid.
All right, I'm gonna stop it there. There's no good place to stop that song, cause it's like it just keeps, you're like, what's gonna happen? Very, very different style of music. But for me, at least, like super engaging. Like every time I hear this song, even though I kind of know what's happening, like I just want to keep grabbing on. How does that one hit you? Just like emotionally, things you notice, how the style feels, what the aesthetic feels like. And then maybe we'll try to talk about like where we might put this on our map.
So I think the first thing I noticed was that it was more, I don't know, was that a guitar in the background?
Mm-hmm.
I think, I'm assuming, some kind of string instrument. And then you have the drums, you have the singer, and then that's it. So there's less, like, everything's open. There's a lot of space in between all the music. And, like, if you're listening to the song, like, you'll hear the drums, guitar, and then there'll be, like, space. And then music comes in again. So there's a lot of, like, time in between. And then also, like,
and so I'm gonna, sorry to interrupt you, but I want to follow that up.
No, yeah.
Excellent observation. And so what is the psychological aspect? When somebody is playing music and it's going and going and there's all these things happening, that's one thing. When someone's playing music and then there's a pause and you're waiting for the next thing, how does that make you feel when somebody talks that way or when somebody plays music that way? What is the effect of all those spaces and silences?
I think first it makes you like think about like what you just heard before the silence, but then I think the silence also makes you like foreshadow like, okay, what's going to happen next. So it's kind of the anticipation, like as I'm looking at the graph, I can see that.
Yeah.
Anticipation. Yeah. So.
Yeah. I think it makes people uncomfortable too. I think when there's too many silences, it makes people uncomfortable, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. Like to say something like, if we've all had been in a class where the teacher like talks and it never ends, or been with on a date in a conversation with a relative where it's just like blah, 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 you know, and you kind of tune out. When someone takes a real pause and they're about to say something, that makes you tune in. And I totally agree that the way it's electric guitar and bass and drums, and later on there's a little bit of organ that comes in, but it's very stripped down. So like every time there's a space, even in his vocals, right? Like, he'll say something and then follow it up, you know? And on top of that, the lyrics like are not like soothing and comforting. Like there's that line, like, I saw you on your bicycle. And then the next line is, I didn't know you had a bicycle.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's not even like, like letting you off the hook that way. So anyway, so continue, you were saying, so there's that sense of anticipation and there's the space.
Yeah, I was going to say that thing that you just mentioned about the lyrics, that it was hard to follow at first, but then it was like telling a story, but it got all confusing in my head because that part about the bicycle,
mm-hmm.
And it was like, my friend came back on the bicycle, but then I thought he didn't have a bicycle or something like that. So I was like, okay, wait a second. So then I had to like think about that for a little bit, but yeah, it kind of made me reflect on the song more and took everything slower, and I think like the spacing and the time in the music help with that. So
I agree with all those observations, and again, like the same way when we look at these emotions, you know, like being afraid or depressed or obsessive or angry is not a bad thing. Like those are normal natural reactions. They only become bad things if we let them take over our life and they inhibit us like in a long, prolonged way, you know? So I think, you know, like you're 17 and we're speaking to teenagers at home, like, you know, like life is an up and down ride, and not being too melodramatic, but like everybody, it's not an if, you will hit times where you get stuck in these emotional ruts and you're experiencing difficult emotions. But sometimes it happens on a daily basis, like, you know, I mean, I'm quarantined with a 4.5-year-old, so like I'm going through some like pretty emotional rides, but even it can happen on long stretches. Like you could have a year or two or more when things are really difficult. And so how we deal with those is even more important than when and how they land on us. There's something about, for me, this is a singer named Tony Scherr. Tony Scherr is a great bass player and guitarist, and he also writes songs, and I don't think he's like the best quote-unquote vocalist. I'm sure he would say the same thing, but there's something about the song, the pacing of it, like you said, the space of it, like you said, the sort of convolutedness of the story, like he's telling the story and it seems very honest, but it's also like, it's almost like he didn't bother to rhyme the words because he doesn't have to, like he's just telling the story and that's it. And it's a little discomforting, but in the same way, it's also like very, very engaging. Did you hear that part in the middle where the organ comes in and it sort of like goes to a major key and it brightens up a little bit?
Yeah, yeah.
So that's kind of a nice relief. And then for me, at least, I kind of thought like, oh, okay, we've been through the negative part and it got better. And then it goes back to the verse. You're like, you know, where would you put this? And I know this is, again, this is sort of an abstract thing, but where would you put this on the wheel? Do you feel like this is more positive or more negative? Do you feel like it's more active or more passive? Or are there any of those emotions that stick out to you? Or you can even use your own if you don't like my choices.
Well, I think this is more active rather than like the other songs we've listened to. Mm-hmm. And the word that sticks out the most is anticipation. Just a song pulls that word straight out with all the spacing and the gaps and the time. So I think anticipation probably around there near the happy and active.
Cool. I love it. I love that interpretation. For me, this was on my Afraid playlist. So I had the total opposite reaction that you did. But that's okay. And actually, as I listened to it, I was thinking that this really, to me, feels a little more active than it did passive. So I had that same thought that you did. I would agree with everything you said. For me, this feels a little more anxious because for me, anticipation feels like anticipating something that I'm like positive, like excited about. Mm-hmm. Whereas anxiety is more like the activity over something that I can't necessarily control. And so for me, this song feels like I'm not sure. It feels to me like a situation where I'm not exactly sure what's happening, what's coming next. But but this is the whole point of this session, to say that this map is just a beginning place to get people thinking about where music fits in emotionally and how they might use it. Tharun's interpretation is every bit as valid as mine. And in fact, like, I would encourage you to make your own like diagram, make your own list. There's something about anticipation that can go both positive and negative. And whatever you call it, this is the same thing with this song, is that there's a feeling that's both positive and negative in this story. It seems somehow cathartic, but also it's very like a little bit unsettling. Really, really, I like what you have to say. As a follow-up, and this is a hard conversation, but could you see a song like this fitting into a situation in your life? Like either in the short run of like the sort of soundtrack of your day or your week, or in the longer run of like when you mentioned like wanting to go back to older songs when you were missing your parents or looking forward to like a new direction, where is there a place where you see might see this fit in?
The song, you mean?
Yeah.
That's a good question. Yeah, I think so. I think the anxious part, the uncertainty, the anticipation, all that, like, I think that's like a day-to-day thing for me. It's like, especially during this quarantine time, it's like, what's going to happen next? Like, I don't know what's happened. Everything's so spacey and wish-washy. So that the anxiousness, but also like the activeness, like, okay, what am I going to do about it? Like, what's going to happen? So I think that fits in right now during this quarantine time perfectly, I think.
Yeah.
This is a song I would listen to.
That's a very thoughtful answer. Something came up in a discussion I had with someone else about this idea of like, how much do you want to sit with something and how much do you want to move past it? You know, and I think that that's different for everyone and it's different for every scenario. You know, like if I'm putting this, like if just for argument's sake, going back to my diagram, this feels anxious to me, right? The same way that happy and sad are opposites. If this feels anxious to me, meaning that it's sad and a little bit more active than not, I might want to move to a place that's the opposite of that, a place that's happy and a little more passive. So I might want to go into something dreamy. So, and I hadn't actually planned this, but just thinking about like the first song we listened to, the coffee, the Sylvan Esso song, right? Mm-hmm. For me, I could see being in a scenario where I'm feeling anxious and I want to sit with something like this. Mm-hmm. And I could also see wanting to move on to something more on the dreamy side to come out of a place like that. And that's different for everybody. I think it's The only thing I'll say as a non-psychologist, as a musician, is that it's okay to embrace that feeling. Like, it's okay to be anxious. You're not a weak person. You're not doing it wrong. You're not a weirdo if you're listening to something that makes you feel a little bit anxious. If you're feeling anxious, and certainly not if you're like sort of sitting with it and dealing with that. It's mm-hmm. also okay at a certain point to be like, all right, like, I'm done with that. I had my good cry or whatever it is, and I want to move on to something else. And, you know, like, that's, it's all a personal thing, but yeah, it was a really thoughtful answer. I like that a lot. We're going to finish up soon. I wanted to play one more thing, and Tharun, I think you might recognize this. I had asked Tharun before we'd had this meeting if there was anything he wanted to recommend. So I'm going to put this one out there. Let's listen to this for a second, and then we'll get Tharun's take, and then we'll get your take. Wow. Awesome. All right, Tharun, you want to introduce this song and tell us what this is all about?
Yeah, so this song is called Work to Do. It's by drummer Carl Allen. And actually, one of the first times I was exposed to this song was when I was at NJPAC in a Jazz for Teens big band program that I played in Newark, New Jersey. And so Carl Allen came in for a masterclass with all the drummers. And he held a competition to see who could feather the bass drum the quietest. And so I won the competition. I was able to play on stage with him at NJPAC.
What is that for non-drummers? What does that mean, feather the bass drum?
So feather the bass drum is if you have like the bass pedal and you have the bass drum, it's how quietly can you hit the bass pedal against the bass drum to make a sound and to like feel the bass drum vibrations, but not actually hear it. So
keeping quarter notes, like keeping quarter notes on the beat, right?
Right. Got especially it. In cool. jazz, keeping quarter notes on the beat. So I won that competition. I got to play with him on stage.
Wow.
And then after he gave me a recording of his new single Work to Do, and then he signed it for me. So I started listening to his music, and I liked the song a lot just because of how upbeat it was, and maybe, you know, brought me back to those memories with Carl Allen, playing on stage with him And it was really scary, but it was the first time I ever played on a really, really big stage with a professional musician. So,
yeah. Wow. That's a great story. Yeah. It's a great song. This album, I was just, while I was listening, I was like being an internet nerd and I looked up who's on it. And he actually made this with Rodney Whitaker, the bass player. And so that's a thing with jazz, is like a lot of people who are not, may not be used to listening to instrumental music with no vocals, no lyrics, but the relationship between the acoustic bass player and the drummer is a really strong one in a jazz unit. And so if you go back to listen to that song or other songs in this vein, one of the things you can, people at home can focus on is the interaction between the bass and the drums, because even though they're playing a pattern, there's a lot of improvisation going on between that. I love your, it's a great story. Congrats for being able to do that. And, you know, that even Tharun is obviously a performer, but even if you don't have a performance background, you don't have an experience like that, the story, the idea of having an experience that's tied to a musical, a piece of music, is a really strong one. And no matter where it lands on any emotional map, like if you have a connection between a piece of music that you listen to with a friend, you listen to when something very important happened, either positive or negative, you listen to in the car or on a plane on your way someplace. Like sometimes people will have like a playlist or like a little soundtrack for a certain like event in their life. Anytime you can tie an emotion to a piece of music, and that means going forward also, like if you decide like, this is the day that I start running, like I got to exercise, I got to do it, even if I go like 100 yards and back, like this is the song I put on to motivate me to do something new, that can form part of that new memory. So that the story is a really good example of how meaningful it is. It's a great song, but it would not be nearly as important to you, I don't think, if you hadn't had that whole thing and meeting the artist and getting it signed. And he's, Carl Allen's like a big dude, right? So I imagine that even just like looking up at him being like, oh, thank you, Mr. Allen, you know, like that's a meaningful thing. So yeah, really cool. Where do you use a song like this in your life? Where does this come in for you? During the day, during your week, or just on the scale of what's come in the past and what you're looking forward to in the future, where do you see the song fitting in?
Well, I think it's kind of like a new song. It's like more like, I would say, modern, jazz, modern music. And the song wasn't made too long ago, but I think so. It reminds me of what happened in the past, but I think it keeps me in the future in the like modern jazz music. So like on the scale of like past to future, it's like right in the middle.
Cool.
Yeah.
I like that what you said before too about the idea of action, that it has a little bit of a call to action to you, and that's a nice thing. It's like it's not just nostalgia, it's not just like background music, that it actually means something, like moving forward in my life, this is something that motivates me to be better, do better, you know, keep going, all that kind of stuff. So
yeah,
man, awesome. Cool. Tharun, I really so much appreciate your time today, all the thoughtful responses, and obviously your dedication to listening closely. I mean, listening to me is hard enough, like for an hour, but more so, I mean, listening to the music and taking it seriously. I'm so glad it's finding a place in your life, not only as a performer, but just as a person of character who's, you know, a teenager who's going through a lot like everybody else is. I really encourage everyone at home to start thinking about the music that you're listening to and that you're looking for. Whether it be from social media, from your friends, from videos, even like, God forbid, like looking at maybe your parents' musical tastes and thinking like what might have taken them there. One of the other songs, just a quick side note, that Tharun put in was a Stevie Wonder song. Now, I don't know how you could be a human being and not be a fan of Stevie Wonder. Those two seem like irreconcilable to me, but I shouldn't make a judgment. It's possible that people don't like Stevie, but I smiled when I saw that because Stevie Wonder is one of the things that my dad and I have in common. You know, he supports me and he listens to music and he appreciates what I do, but like we really totally connect on Stevie Wonder. Like we get it on the same level. So it was cool to see you put that in there. Like you might be surprised. Your parents might actually know something about music, or they might have something to share, and you might have something to share with them. You know, like it's possible that you could bring something in and they say, oh, that's like rippity rappity hippity hoppity trash, I can't listen. It's like, well, actually, like we're stuck in the house now, so maybe you should listen to what I have to say about this. And but thank you, Tharun, for all your insight. I hope everybody at home will take on the challenge. Not only the way that I've pointed out this emotional wheel, but put together your own set of emotions and meanings and what makes sense to you and map it out. We'll post some copies of these playlists and all that stuff. Again, you've been listening to Tharun, and my name is Jesse Neuman. I'm the director of Musicworks, www.musicworksnyc.org. This is session 316, Musicworks session 316. Shout out to all my HLC peeps who are listening to this. Thanks, Tharun. I hope your quarantine goes well, and we will talk to you all soon. Bye, everyone.